Today on Matters of Fact, Vice President Leni Robredo drew sharp criticism from security agencies for describing President Rodrigo Duterte's drug war as a massive failure. Her conclusions were based on data she got as co-chair of Duterte's Interagency Committee on Illegal Drugs, or ICAD, for 18 days. But agencies such as the Philippine Drug Enforcement Agency, or PDEA, are disputing these numbers. Joining us today is Director Derrick Carreon. He's the spokesman of the Philippine Drug Enforcement Agency. Good morning, sir, and thank you for joining us.
Magandang umaga, sir, on behalf of Director General Aaron Aquino.
Okay, sir, this was described as many people disputed this report by the Vice President, and specifically on the part of PDEA, this was described as based on what? Wild assumptions, right?
Yes, sir.
Why is that so?
Yes, because in fact, the PNP also admitted that this was a mental exercise on their part during one of the sessions of the senior officials of the PNP. In a separate interview, we were with the spokesperson of the Philippine National Police. That is why he mentioned that during a closed-door session with officers of the PNP Drug Enforcement Group and several other senior officers of the PNP, they just wanted to have a picture of what industry we're up against. And so they came up with hypothetical figures. In fact, yes, wild assumptions. And this is why we are disputing the grade that was given to us, that is like 1%.
I think just to put things in perspective,
yes,
what was described as a massive failure was specific to supply constriction, entire drug war.
Yes, sir. Nevertheless, that is why. And we are really in uproar against this because para naman pong tinawaran yung sakripisyo. I hope you don't mind if I speak also in Tagalog. It's like, you know, downplaying the sacrifices of all those people who put their lives and limbs on the line every day. Our agency, the PNP, the other frontliners like the NBI, the AFP. Sir, we've lost 10 agents from the start of this intensified campaign against illegal drugs. The PNP has its own casualties. We have scores wounded. And then we've confiscated a total volume of 5.34 tons. How could you call that a massive failure when you put it in juxtaposition with, if you want to play the assumption game, we also have figures of our own that are more plausible.
So what are the figures that are more plausible?
All right, sir. If you want to put, if you want to play the assumption game, let's put it this way.
For example, specific, how big is the drug volume being consumed in the Philippines now?
It is not 3 tons per week, definitely. But if we will construe it from the figures of surrenderers starting in July 1, 2016, which is pegged at 1.3 million, and then in ratio in proportion to the total number of households, Philippine households, total number of households visited, and the percentage of known drug users and drug pushers, we came up with a computation which led us to the figure of about 4.7. So put it at 4 million. Yun po yung maladala sa babanggit during that time, 4 million.
Drug users?
Yes, drug users, okay. Of which 94% are using shabu. So we came up with a computation at 0.04 gram.
Per user?
Per use. Sir, it's not, you know, I've been a regional director, assistant regional director, and then regional director as well. There's no way that a single drug user will use more than that amount.
So this is a...
This is a more or less standard figure. Yung po nakikita nyo maliliit na pakete, doon na binibenta sa streets, that's about 0.03, 0.04.
Okay.
Now, there are different degrees of use depending on the level of drug dependence of a person. So the estimated consumption per year would be about 23.74 tons. Multiply that by 42 months, which is the current administration's tenure, we will come up with the 83.09.
Okay.
So put 5.34 tons in comparison to that total figure of 83.09, the batting average would be like 6.43%.
43%?
Yeah, 6.43 and not 1%. But sir, there's more. We have dismantled 14 clandestine shabu laboratories in varying sizes, small, medium, and large. The projected yield of this is about 96.65 tons that we prevented from being manufactured.
Okay.
So factor that in together with the 5.34 tons, our batting average would be about more than 23% higher than the total estimated consumption for the past 42 months.
So how would you describe this particular batting average?
Well, we have delivered 23% more than the 42 months consumption. So lampas pa po kami.
So definitely,
we are not a failure.
Okay. Now, how do you compare that with the way they're going after supply in other countries that are also heavily infested by illegal drugs? Just to put things in perspective. For example, Mexico or let's say in Southeast Asia?
Well, sir, the situation there is actually much worse.
Oh. But in terms of percentages, because sometimes we need something to compare ourselves with. Diba?
Mahirap po mag-compare with other countries. We don't have their data.
But definitely this is high.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, ganito na lang po. Mahirap po, we don't want to put any blaming fingers, but nevertheless, you want a comparison. The immediate past administration, the figure for the past 6 years is about 3.29 tons.
Okay.
6 years yun, sir. And we're talking about 5.43 with this administration only a little over 3 years. We must be doing something right, sir. Okay. And the metrics of success of the anti-drug campaign are not limited to operational accomplishments alone. We have to factor in barangay drug clearing. We have to factor in the crime index and, of course, the trust ratings. And, of course, the fourth would be operational accomplishments. One of the indicators would be confiscation of bulk supply of dangerous drugs.
Okay, now this percent, 6.43%, right?
Yes, sir.
Of the projected drug consumed.
Yeah,
in the Philippines.
That is only for confiscation.
Only for confiscation. Did you make this particular figure available to the Vice President during her tenure or term as ICAD co-chair?
I believe if we construe it in terms of the law enforcement cluster, this might have been laid out if it were asked during the meeting. Unfortunately, I was not there during the law enforcement cluster meeting. But sir, we can only take note of a few meetings held since she took the helm of co-chair. After accepting the position, there was a mother ICAD meeting on November
8th
at the office of the Vice President that was widely covered by media. The four clusters rendered briefs on their respective accomplishments, and the Dangerous Drugs Board presented the Philippine anti-drug strategy. Mm. After that, November 14, she met with the law enforcement cluster. And this is where the modus operandi and probably another a more comprehensive brief of accomplishments was rendered.
You weren't there.
But I wasn't there. But definitely, sabi po ng PNP and the other participating agencies, hindi naman po kasama doon sa meeting na yun, yung sinasabing wild estimate.
My point is this. This is something, this is a very crucial figure that should have been made known to the Vice President as ICAD co-chair. This was not something that you wouldn't give unless requested by the Vice President.
Well, perhaps, as I said, I wasn't there during the meeting, but perhaps during the course of discussions, this might have been raised. Kasi ang nangyari po rito, there were questions also on the baseline. Because there are several figures that were being argued against. But as we said, if you want a tangible baseline based on what we started with in 2016 when the intensified anti-drug campaign began, it's at 4 million and then at 94% of 4 million being shabu users. Of course, there were several other figures that came out there.
Because this is one way of looking at this particular situation.
Sir.
For example, if this figure of yours were made available to the Vice President, but she didn't use them, so basically, she just picked and chose. That's one possibility.
Maybe, sir.
Diba?
Perhaps.
Pero obviously, this was something that should have been made available to her.
Well, yeah, okay. I will go out on a limb and say probably it might have been mentioned in passing. Or baka nga po, hindi natanong, hindi rin nasagot. But either way, what we're trying to say, sir, is...
But it's very obvious, diba? It's very basic.
Opo. Ang sa akin lang is, hindi rin po nabanggit yung sinasabi niyong naging basis ng 1%. Eh. The wild estimate or the wild assumption?
It was mentioned in the report that it was based on data or figures coming from the PNP Drug Enforcement Group.
Well, yes, but even the PNP denies mentioning these figures during the law enforcement cluster meeting.
There were footnotes. Basically, if you read the report, right?
Well,
there were footnotes referring to where certain data or figures were sourced. For example, if the figure came out during a meeting at ICAD, it's mentioned in the footnote.
Well, we are certain that the 5.34 was definitely reported. As regards the other data, assumed data, that was made the basis for the juxtaposition of figures, as I cannot say for certain if, like for instance, yun nga po, the three ton per week estimate, hindi po talaga nabanggit yun. No agency laid claim to mentioning that.
Now, how do you think this conclusion by the Vice President would impact on the drug enforcement side of the anti-drug strategy? You guys are at the front line. Somehow, does this diminish the gains, or somehow this could cast doubt further on the drug war?
We would look at it, sir, as a challenge for us to prove that indeed we are making a dent on the anti-illegal or the illegal drug industry. The fact that we are not, as also claimed by others, we are only focusing on street-level operations. Sir, that's not true. Before Christmas, on December 24, we were at Tabayok Street in Barangay Siena, here in Quezon City, and we confiscated another 120 kilograms of shabu, of which the suspect was a foreign national. So that is definitely not street level as well, and that was our Christmas gift to the people back then.
But actually, the conclusion, I think, in the report was not only referring specifically to PDEA, but to the entire drug war.
Well,
and
sir,
I think more specifically to the PNP.
Well, sir, we cannot discount the fact that, yes, the PNP has more units down the line who also address street-level activities. But it is not to say that even the PNP has neglected large-scale shabu or illegal drug activities, because the PNP is participatory to, let's say, for instance, the 330 kilos that was presented in Kamkrame, that was a PNP-initiated operation by the Drug Enforcement Group.
Okay, now let's talk about baseline data. This is one of the recommendations in the report. Basically, in so many words, or just to be plain about it, how many drug users are actually there in the Philippines?
Again,
you started and 3 years after.
Yes, we will reckon from the time when we started at 4 million. Mm-hmm. The Dangerous Drugs Board has already conducted, and we believe they've just concluded their survey and will eventually come out with a more plausible figure. As mentioned by the DILG, they are on board in this effort already. Just to make sense of all these figures eventually, they're helping out as well in the survey. And so hopefully we come out with a more plausible figure.
But so far, you're using 4 million.
But we're using 4 million because this is what we started with. Based on, this is more plausible, sir, because we have the number of surrenderers as a basis, and then the households. Households visited versus total Philippine households, and then the 80% figure that we identified based on the result of. Kaya nga po pangit din na nasabihin na we abandoned Tokhang, because Tokhang was very helpful in identifying.
At saka dito nakalagay, it's mentioned 1.5 million drug users have been accounted for.
Yes,
basically identified based on those who surrendered.
Yes, and then those who surrendered were because of Project Tokhang.
Okay.
And sir, we have to also make mention, I'm sorry, just to clarify, I'll take this opportunity to help the PNP explain that Tokhang is not an anti-drug operation. It is a mere simple activity of going into households, knocking and pleading and enticing them to come back to the fold of the law and be accounted for and submit themselves for appropriate intervention.
Yeah, that is the very good side of the Project Tokhang or Oplan Tokhang. But I think the problem was there have been several reports or many reports that, let's say, someone was identified during Project Tokhang. He had himself listed as part of the drug list in the barangay. He ended up dead in the hands of motorcycle riding assailants.
Well, sir, but of course, motorcycle riding assailants cannot be automatically associated with government troops. Mahirap naman po siguro yun. It can be any possibility. It can even be their connections in the illegal drug trade.
That's true.
Taking them down.
But there are also reports that it could have been also the policemen who were themselves behind those operations.
That's why there are investigations that are in line with these incidents, I guess.
Yeah, this is already beyond the scope of their responsibility. But I think that since you raised that issue regarding Project Oplan Tokhang, that was also one of the issues raised against the PNP. Mm-hmm. How legitimate is the investigation when it comes to these deaths in the hands of these motorcycle riding men? Because this could also puts a dent on the legitimacy of the drug operation.
Well, that's a valid point of concern, sir. But nevertheless, again, we'll leave it to the PNP as they're still investigating all these. And
now, let's go first to the 4 million drug users figure. So basically, in the absence of an updated survey, this is the figure that PDEA at least is going by.
We're going by this.
You're using this. What do you make of the president's estimate of 7 to 8 million drug users?
Well, that can be also possible because all these are just estimates, sir. As new data come in, the president, being the president, has access to a wide array of sources of information, which they can also validate with the help of intelligence agencies.
But how come your figure is somehow very much different from the president?
Well, sir,
you're the primary drug enforcement agency.
Sir, first and foremost, our job is more on law enforcement. And so we only use this as a tool for determining a plausible figure regarding the consumption. If we really want to make an assumption on what is the possible consumption of drugs. But our main job is to really curtail the supply and at the same time assist in demand reduction. And Director General Aquino, having seen the situation on the streets, has even ventured into what we already added as a third prong into our approach, which is harm reduction. Harm reduction is defined differently in some sectors in the international scene. But for the purpose of the Philippine drug situation, we defined it as mitigating the harms of the illegal drug activities and as well as as the effects to those who are offending or against the law, and then at the same time who are using drugs. So we came up with reformatory programs alongside rehabilitation. Ano po ito? Balay silangan, catering to drug offenders who were compelled to join the illegal drug trade for lack of any gainful means of livelihood. And more important, the continuing vicious cycle of children roaming the streets sent out by their parents so that they can earn any amount through legal or illegal means. So we came up with Sagip Batang Solvent.
Okay, I'll go to the rehabilitation aspect later on, but let's wrap this issue regarding the baseline figure first.
Yes,
now, if you're going by 4 million drug users, and at the start of the campaign of the president, they went by the estimate by the DDB, I think 1.8 million. So dumami pa?
No, sir. In
or not necessarily?
No, in fact, sir, hindi po tinanggap yung figure na 1.8. In fact, matagal na po lumabas yan before. There was a survey, I think, in 2004 that cited 1.8 million regular users and 1.6 million or 1.3 occasional users.
Actually, this estimate as a background by the DDB at that time cost him his position.
Well,
he was sacked because of that. We know that.
But again, anyway, sir, if we reckon back to the figures being mentioned by our president back then, it was running between 3 to 4 million.
So
he was even citing former PDEA chief and former DDB chair General Dionisio Santiago a lot during that time.
Who was also sacked because of his comment regarding
the story as well, sir, but
because of the drug rehabilitation center in Nueva.
But if you recall, when he started out very early on before, he kept mentioning that it's about 3 million and then eventually 4 million. Kasi nga, when we came out with the figures of surrenderers, nagkaroon po na malinaw-linaw na picture eh. More or less tama yung 4 million if we were to use it on the computation of the stratified triangulated extrapolation of drug users or drug surrenderers versus households.
Okay, now let's talk about the so-called imbalance, which was mentioned in the Robredo report.
Yes,
the imbalance,
sir,
between enforcement and rehabilitation, because you mentioned rehabilitation. Now, this was a very legitimate issue raised because she went by the actual budget allocated on enforcement and rehabilitation activities in the General Appropriations Act 2017, 2018, and then 2019. There's a disparity, obviously. So isn't that a very clear indicator indeed there's an imbalance?
Well, yes, we that's why our Director General, in fact, after reading all these reports submitted by the Honorable Vice President, tasked the different clusters of the ICAD to take note of all these observations and eventually submit a report of action taken on this in the next ICAD meeting. And he gave this instruction before the end of 2019. So in the next ICAD meeting, probably by next month or not later than March, he's expecting results or reports from the clusters concerned on these recommendations.
When you say action, they will act on the recommendations?
Yes, sir.
Or they will dispute the recommendations?
No. They want, the DG wants that such recommendations, if applicable or plausible, be implemented or acted upon.
Okay.
Hindi naman po namin, kumbaga, itatatwa kung may kailangan na, if there are points of improvement to the campaign, we are definitely open to such recommendations.
Okay, that's a good point that
you
raised, because
so far,
if you look at the way, if you look at the back and forth between the vice president and agencies like yours, it seems like there's a total rejection.
No, sir. That is one thing we'd like to clarify. Director General Aquino, before the end of the year, met the ICAD and said, take note of all these recommendations, especially those that are implementable or that can be possibly considered. And I will ask you on what actions we are taking in order to take note. Like, for instance, sir, the DILG has already made mention that they're open to revising the implementation of Tokhang, whereby if not civil society groups, it's the church that will lead. And the police will only be there to ensure security and safety in the event that, for instance, this can happen, sir. This may happen, God forbid. In the course of the Tokhang, taga-simbahan po yung kumatok or civil society, eh nakagamit po yung tao. Eh paano kung napraning at nagwala? At least the police will be there to make sure that the safety will be ensured on the part of the group.
So that's one recommendation. That's one change that you're going to implement. How about others? For example, when it comes to institutionalizing community-based drug rehabilitation.
Yes, sir. That is under the advocacy cluster of the ICAD, spearheaded by the DILG. And in fact, there are figures that were mentioned by the DILG that they have over 140,000 clients or patients of the community-based rehab. Our Balay Silangan effort caters to reformation, which is different from health rehab.
Yeah.
Ito naman po, yung mga, we are retooling their mindset that there is life or livelihood outside of the illegal drug trade. And so they have a reformatory program, and eventually we will help them come up with plausible livelihood so that they don't go back to being runners or small-time pushers on the illegal
drug
trade.
But when it comes to community-based drug rehabilitation, one of the recommendations is to not just institutionalize community-based drug rehabilitation, come up with a with an evidence-based program, and of course put sufficient funding in all these centers to make sure that they will be able to hire actual experts,
yes, sir,
like nurses, doctors, psychometricians. Because sometimes you can put up your own community-based drug rehab, but you don't have the people to staff them, right?
That's true. Well, as we said, sir, these are good recommendations, and perhaps the powers that be have already taken note as well. In terms of the budget side, I'm sure, as already tasked by DG Aaron Aquino, the clusters concerned will definitely work towards taking into considering all these recommendations and taking them into account so that we can improve our effort.
Now, another important thing, supply constriction. What do you intend to do when it comes to that aspect for the next 2.5 years?
Sir, we're doing something right, as we may mention. That's why umaangal nga po kami. Na, huwag naman tawaran yung effort namin dahil hindi po madali ang ganitong trabaho. But definitely, we will continue with our strategy of arresting high-value targets, conducting high-impact operations, identifying the sources of the illegal drug industry, and halting them before they even come inside or enter the country. We've been very successful on this, in fact, with the Bureau of Customs already accommodating us anytime we want to make inspections. We put up, we just recently signed another memorandum of agreement with the National Coast Watch Center, which helps us monitor the coastlines, which are the most porous points of entry for smuggling of illegal drugs. We're continuously monitoring reports on clandestine laboratories, which are also part of the main sources of supply of illegal drugs.
Okay, Director Derrick Carreon, thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.